Hey guys, welcome back to my channel. Today we are going to be discussing the case of Holly Bobo. Holly disappeared on April 13th, 2011 from Darden, Tennessee, and her brother was the last person to have seen her alive. So Holly was 20 years old, totally beautiful girl. She was in nursing school at the University of Tennessee at Martin, and she was still living at home with her brother and both of her parents. People that knew her described her as shy but sweet, and she was actually the cousin of country singer Whitney Duncan, who actually released a song in Holly's honor in 2017, and here's a little bit of that song. So while doing the research on this case, I found a timeline that is pretty consistent with everything else that I've found, and I always think that timelines are the best way to work through a case. So we have a timeline of all of the events that took place on the morning of April 13th, 2011. We know that all of this happened based on witness statements and on phone records that were able to prove that some of these calls were made. So it was an exam day, and as I said, Holly was a nursing student. Nursing is not easy. So she woke up at 4:30 in the morning to start studying. Her boyfriend ended up calling her at about 7:30 a.m. His name was Drew Scott, and he was turkey hunting nearby on Holly's grandmother's property. Her brother Clint was still asleep at this time, and both of Holly's parents had left for work already. But 12 minutes later at 7:42 a.m., Holly Bobo made her final phone call, at least from her own phone. And at this point, all of the incoming calls and texts that were coming into Holly's phone were unanswered. And according to my sources, a little bit, like really soon after this call was ended, witnesses heard a scream near Holly's house. A few minutes later at 7:46 a.m., the neighbor that overheard the scream called their mother because they were really concerned, and so the mother ended up calling Holly Bobo's mom, whose name was Karen Bobo. Just a few minutes later at 7:50 a.m., Clint, Holly's brother, was awoken by their dogs barking. He said he saw a man with Holly outside, and it appeared to be her boyfriend, Drew. They were kneeled down and facing each other in the garage, so he didn't get a full look at the man's face. They were talking back and forth, and apparently Holly sounded super upset, and Clint really doesn't know why. He couldn't make out any of the words that they were saying back and forth to each other. The only thing he could make out was at one point Holly saying, "No, why?" That's all he could make out. Now, at some point, Karen Bobo, who had gotten that call from her neighbor, called home and was talking to Clint. Clint explained that he saw Drew with Holly, and Karen said to him, "Clint, that's not Drew. Go shoot him." And Clint still thought that this man was Holly's boyfriend, so he was like, "You really want me to go shoot Drew?" And she was adamant that this was not her boyfriend because she knew he was turkey hunting on Holly's grandmother's property. Just a few minutes before 8 a.m., Holly Bobo's mom, Karen, called 911. But apparently there was a delay here because she was calling from work, which was a different county in which she lived in, so she reached a dispatcher from a completely different county. But then they were able to get everything straightened out, and Clint at home saw this man dressed in camouflage and walking with Holly. And where were they walking? Into the woods. And at this point in time, Clint is realizing that this man with Holly is much larger than her boyfriend, Drew. And so he's now fully realizing that this is not her boyfriend that she's with. He tried to call Holly's cell phone, and he also tried to call Holly's boyfriend's cell phone, and neither of them were able to answer. At 8 a.m., Karen Bobo called home once again to speak with Clint. Clint told his mother what he saw, and she said to call 911. So he actually got a loaded pistol to defend himself and went outside, where he found blood stains, a lot of blood stains in the carport, and he wasn't exactly sure whose blood this was, but later it was confirmed to be Holly's. So police arrived at Holly's residence at about 8:10 a.m. And at 8:17 a.m., cell phone tower pings were able to determine that Holly's cell phone was moving away from her house, heading north. Her cell phone kept going north and even further north until it reached a wooded area near Interstate 40. And this wooded area ended up being where Holly's remains were found. From about 8:30 to 9 in the morning that morning, Holly's phone was not moving at all. Then the cell phone started going south and traveling in a completely different direction. And the final ping from Holly Bobo's cell phone came through at about 9:25 in the morning. And this ping was in the same area where her phone and SIM card were found. And as I said, later on, that was where she was found as well. So pretty much all we have at this point is Clint, Holly's brother's, description of this man she was with. He said he was probably about 6 feet tall. He had dark hair under a hat, and his hair was long enough to kind of touch the collar of his shirt. And he also said that the male voice he heard was very deep and low. So many searches, extensive searches, were done in this immediate area after Holly went missing, and a lot of her belongings were found in scattered areas. There was her lunchbox found in one part of town, a receipt that had her name on it was found in a completely different part of town, and same with a card from school. So earlier on in this investigation, the Tennessee Bureau of Investigation were focusing mostly on this one man that was a known sex offender. His name was Terry Britt, and his home was actually wiretapped during this investigation, and they actually ended up searching his home as part of this investigation as well. But they never were able to really find anything, and he was never charged with anything. So Holly Bobo's remains were not found until September 2014 when some hunters stumbled upon her. It was about 20 miles from where she had last been seen at her house. Apparently the owner of this property says that it's not uncommon for people to hunt there without permission. And so these hunters saw a large bucket in the woods that was overturned, and then once they went to go investigate this bucket, they found Holly's remains. They were not able to recover her full body, but they were able to recover her skull, teeth, ribs, or some of her ribs, and her shoulder blade, one of her shoulder blades. And her skull had a bullet hole through the back. So the rest of this is kind of confusing. There are a total of 6 men that have been charged with crimes in relation to Holly's disappearance. The first person was arrested in March of 2014. Now, this was before her remains were found. These two brothers were arrested, Zach Adams and Dylan Adams, and they were also arrested with a friend named Jason Autry, and they were charged with aggravated kidnapping, first-degree murder, and rape of Holly Bobo. Another 2 men were arrested on charges of accessory after the fact and tampering with evidence. And they were also 2 brothers named Jeffrey and Mark Piercy. But interestingly enough, those charges ended up dropping. Another man named Shane Austin, who was said to be somehow related to this case, actually ended up committing suicide. And it isn't fully public what led law enforcement to suspect these 6 men. But apparently when they first arrested Dylan Adams, it was on unrelated weapons charges. And then following this arrest, he told investigators that he actually witnessed Holly Bobo alive after her brother last saw her. He saw her at his brother Zach's house following her abduction. Apparently on that day, he went to his brother's house to get his truck, and he saw her sitting in a green chair in the living room wearing a pink t-shirt, and this guy named Jason Autry standing just a few feet away from her. He said that Zach had raped Holly and recorded it, but this videotape has never been found, this alleged videotape. So Dylan ended up recanting all of his confessions after he basically said everything, but all of the confessions that he did make, even though they were recanted, led to the arrests of Zach Adams, Jason Autry, and Shane Austin. Shane Austin was initially offered immunity in this case if he would just tell authorities where Holly Bobo's body was. They know by phone records that he was in contact with Adams multiple times on the day of Holly's disappearance, and police believe that he helped dispose of her body. So he decided not to come forward and say anything, and the investigators decided that he was not being truthful or forthcoming with any information that he may have had. Austin was found deceased in 2015 in a correctional facility, so it seems he did kill himself. He was actually being held on completely unrelated charges that were before Holly's disappearance, But his attorney blamed the suicide on the witch hunt that the police were going on towards Shane. He said that the police were relying on rumors more than actual investigation. So Jeff and Mark Piercy were charged with accessory after the fact and tampering with evidence. So they were arrested on some really interesting information, and I'm gonna read this directly from my source. They were arrested on the basis of allegations made by Jeff's former roommate, Sandra King, who alleged that in May 2014, Jeff showed her part of a video showing Adams assaulting Bobo, who was tied up and crying. She told police that she watched only a small clip and did not see any sexual assault. So police actually set up a phone call between her and Jeff, where she would mention the video and kind of get him to acknowledge that it existed, and they were able to do that. But both of these brothers, Jeff and Mark, are so adamant that this video does not exist. And they claim that they have never met all of the other men that were arrested for the same crime. Charges against both of these men were subsequently dropped. So next, in 2017, it was time for Zach Adams to go on trial. So there wasn't any DNA or any other forensic evidence. It was all circumstantial evidence, or mostly circumstantial evidence. Jason Autry testified and said a lot of things that completely contradicted the previous story. Jason Autry said he had nothing to do with the abduction. He just went to their house to buy drugs. And he saw Austin and Adams disposing of evidence of a crime. He saw a body in the back of Adams's truck. It was covered in a multicolored blanket and disposed of in a burn barrel. So Jason Autry said that he agreed to help Zach bury the body, so they drove on I-40. They drove to an area near it, and their initial plan when going to dispose of Holly's body was to gut her so that her body would not float to the top of the water, because they were going to dispose her under a bridge in a river. But apparently, when they were taking Holly Bobo out of the truck, or her body out of the truck, they realized that she was still alive, so they shot her in the back of the head. They were worried that the sound of this gunshot would attract attention, so they loaded the body back into the truck and left. And as I said earlier, there was a receipt with Holly Bobo's name found on it very far away from her house. It was in a completely different part of town. This receipt was found only 75 feet away from Austin's driveway. The prosecution also said that Zach Adams drove a white truck and that Holly Bobo's family saw a white truck near the residence, but that doesn't do much for me. A lot of other people actually came forward though and said that Zach Adams had implicated himself in conversations with them, including his ex-girlfriend. She actually came forward and said that one time he threatened to tie her up like he did to that Holly Bobo girl, and that nobody would ever see her again. Zach Adams also allegedly threatened his brother after the killing of Holly Bobo by saying that he would put his brother in a hole next to her if he didn't keep his mouth shut. Zach Adams was found guilty on all charges, including aggravated kidnapping, aggravated rape, and first-degree murder. He was sentenced to life in prison without the possibility of parole, and two consecutive terms of 25 years for the kidnapping and the rape charges. Now, John Dylan Adams, he actually pled guilty in early 2018 to charges of facilitation of first-degree murder and aggravated kidnapping. He was sentenced to 15 years for the facilitation of first-degree murder and 35 years for the aggravated kidnapping. Dylan actually, during this trial, entered the Alford plea, which in the defendant does not admit to doing the criminal act, but they do acknowledge that the prosecution's case might end up in a guilty verdict against them. Now, a lot of these guys that were implicated in this crime claim that the police got information out of them in very inhumane ways by keeping them up for long hours or not allowing them to eat. And there was a lot of extensive coercion in this investigation. So that is pretty much it on the case of Holly Bobo. If you guys enjoyed this video, please give me a thumbs up and let me know any other cases you'd like to hear me talk about down below. Thank you for watching, and I'll see you in my next video. Bye. Can you believe we finally won a football game? Got new sidewalks and a brand new bank.
But still sitting in the same pew every Sunday, singing the same songs the same old way, thinking about you when the preacher prays. But I bet you don't miss this town nobody needs, and that lonesome red light flame. Your old Mustang, your room is the same. You probably don't miss a thing, 'cause your heart don't break in your better place. Brother got married in a rain like hell, and granddaddy ain't been feeling too well. I think your mama's okay, but it's hard to tell. Tries to move on, but ain't going nowhere. We all know this life ain't fair. But I bet you don't miss this town nobody needs, and that lonesome red light. It's like a knife when I hear your name. That's one thing that'll never change. But I bet you don't.